In 2023, it was reported that over 160 heat-related deaths occurred to pets across the nation, which includes excessive heat from an RV or a van left unattended. So how do you keep your pets safe with you while you're traveling in an RV?
If there's one thing RVers have in common with each other, it is that we love traveling with our furry sidekick. Say hi. So in this video, we're gonna be talking about RVing with pets, but more importantly, we're focusing on some pressing things.
How do I plan my travel days around my fur baby? Where does the cat litter box go in the RV when you're living in such a small space? But most importantly, how do you monitor temperature out on the road to make sure your fur babies stay nice and safe?
But also, we've recently done some RV trips with people who have dogs, and boy, have we learned a lot about what it's like to be on the road with dogs.
Now, let's say you're getting ready to hit the road full time, or you're just planning an extended trip. How can you prepare your fur babies ahead of time so you're set up for the best success? Now, if you're a dog owner, you're already a step ahead of the game because dogs usually love car rides. But cats, on the other hand, not so much.
Stinky.
You're stinky.
When we bought our first RV, we actually took our little fur baby with us on all of our trips when we went to the storage unit where the RV was stored. That just got him accommodated being in the car traveling to and from to the RV, and then it gave us some opportunities to actually put him inside the RV so he can get well acquainted with the surroundings.
Go around everywhere, smell everything.
Just get that scent, that natural scent going on. Those feel a lot more at ease with things and be able to adjust faster.
This is great for dogs too, because not only do they get used to the inside of the RV, but they learn how to go down, like up and down those awful steps. That's one thing I see RV owners who have dogs struggle with the most, is getting the dogs up and down the steps that I like to call diving boards.
A big recommendation we have for you guys is take small frequent trips with your RV close to home. So if you have some surrounding areas with state parks or campgrounds, take full advantage of that. It's a great opportunity for you to take your pet out, give some trial runs, have some flexibility with being close to home in case anything goes wrong. Doing all this prep work is not gonna make everything 100% smooth, but we have some great tips coming up that will help address some of these really concerning problems.
Should you schedule a visit with the vet before you go on your trip? Yes.
But before we tell you why, you guys too could be of value to someone else out on the road that is really in need of this information. So we encourage you to share this video with others and your family or friends that can benefit from it. We appreciate you guys.
Vaccinations, microchipping, having a conversation with your vet before you go on a big trip just to make them aware there could be some problems.
Point in case, this is a great example of why you need to take those small frequent trips ahead of time so you can knock out these concerns before you actually hit the road.
Yeah, you could go to the vet and say, we went on a long trip. It was only like 2 hours, went camping. The dog was anxious the whole time.
Or they're like nausea, vomiting. These are all concerns that pet owners have to face out on the road. And there's medications and things you can do. So talk with your veterinarian and discuss these things before hitting the road. The other thing I want to say about the microchipping that you brought up before, it's really cheap. It sounds expensive, but it's only like 15 bucks an animal. And the reason that is so important is because when you're out on the road, local veterinarians or other people can take these animals into areas that have the microchipping available. They could scan your pet and have all the information readily available to contact you in case you lose your pet along the way, which is unfortunate. So you want to set yourself up for the most success.
Planning to head to Mexico or Canada in your RV? You will need a vaccination record for your little fur babies. I will say, for the amount of times we did border crossings, they never asked for that document.
No, they didn't, but we had it all on hand and ready to go just in case. It's a required document you must have. Make sure you get it before leaving.
This is rare, but we've even seen on some RV park websites in the US that they require a vaccination record if you're bringing your dogs in to stay. Have you guys ever experienced that? Please comment below if an RV park has ever asked you guys for vaccination records.
Speaking of which, how about RV parks? What all do you need to know before going out on the road with your pet? Booking a site at an RV park? How much do they need to know from you?
Have you ever noticed if you're booking an RV site that they'll ask how many adults, how many children, and how many pets? I guess it's good to know if you have any pets, But what we found out in the fine print is some places will charge you per pet.
Oh, don't worry, it gets much better. What is classified as a pet? Well, to be completely honest and transparent, we don't even consider Dexter a pet because he strictly stays indoors. He does not bother anyone in the campground. You'll never see him, you'll never hear from him. But if you're traveling with dogs, it's certainly something you have to disclose to the RV park ahead of time.
What about that one time we went to stay at that state park in Pennsylvania and we kind of like snuck Dexter in? Should we tell them that story?
You want to put that out on the internet? Of course you do.
So this one time we were booking a short stay at a state park in Pennsylvania, and the website was very adamant about saying this loop is a no pet site. Like, there's no pets allowed in this loop. And we get it. When they say that, they usually mean dogs. Mm-hmm. It's like, no dogs. But we have an indoor cat. He doesn't even want to stick his head out the window, let alone go outside.
So Renee took it upon herself to commit fraud and got us kicked out. No, I'm just kidding. It was strictly just a situation we kept it under wraps and just a little hidden secret between us and now you guys.
But the person checking us in at the state park was looking at us and kept saying, "Are you sure you don't have any pets?" And I was like, "Oh no, oh no, she knows." Whenever we do say we have a cat when we're booking over the phone, they usually say something like, "Ah, they don't count." But if you have dogs, yes, I would definitely make them aware.
They're gonna ask the breed of the dog, how many dogs you're traveling with, and then they're gonna ask you a whole slew. Well, not ask you, they're gonna provide you with a whole slew of rules that you have to abide by. It's a lot.
Whenever we check into an RV park and they hand us the rules, that's the moment we're grateful we don't have a dog, because you'll have, this section will be like normal park rules, and then this whole page that's this long will be like pet rules. There's so many rules if you have a dog.
Leash at all times, no tethering the dogs outside, no leaving the dogs unattended in the RV, no fences outside that keep the dog enclosed on your RV side itself.
No barking, no breathing. What happens if you're full-time RV and you want to go on a trip? And you're full-time, so you are going somewhere where you can't take your pets and you need somebody to watch them. What do you do?
I recommend that you guys look on Google. It's a great resource for actually just finding local pet sitters in your area. You'll get a good range of reviews, and that will kind of bring you some peace of mind. That's something I heavily rely upon when looking for a pet sitter on the road. For the most part, there's some amazing pet services out there for you to use, so just take a look. But let's just say none of this is applicable to you. You're not concerned with finding pet sitters on the road. You just want to understand the dynamics of traveling with a pet on travel days. Where do you take your breaks? How often do you travel taking them for walks, using the bathroom? There's a lot to consider.
An RV that you tow behind you with the truck is going to be different than an RV that you drive yourself. We have a tow behind RV, so we're going to go over how travel days are like with that situation. FYI, if you have an RV that you tow behind you, don't put your pets in the RV while it's being pulled. Just don't do it.
You think it would make sense to keep them in the home while you're traveling, but there's just way too much going on back here. Cabinet doors can open, things can fall out of the cabinets and hurt your pet. There's just a lot of moving pieces here, so keep them safe with you in your travel vehicle pulling the RV. Now, 12 hours prior to departure, we actually start a checklist for ourselves to help make travel days go so much smoother, especially traveling with a cat. You'll be surprised how well this actually works.
What we found works best for Dexter and all of us is that we have a little crate carrier situation.
Yeah.
And he loves that because it gives him a little safe space. We get it that there are some cats out there that like to not be in a crate and they want to run around the truck and they want to look at stuff.
Right.
But that is not the case for Dexter.
So having that out the night before kind of helps him get more acquainted with the actual travel day quicker, because he has his original toys that are always with him on travel days inside that crate. He could snuggle up to them, smell them, and be a little more comfortable during the travel day.
We also like to make sure the day of travel that we're not traveling during his feeding times. Dexter eats at 6 a.m. and 6 p.m. So guess when we're on the road.
He's a very routine guy. But we try not to fill up his belly before getting on the road because we don't want to upset it in any way either.
Yeah.
We've never had any issues with him vomiting in the crate before.
Maybe once.
Maybe once, but we try not to like add to that concern at all. And my favorite is no pre-travel naps. You think that's horrible, right? You're like, let your pet sleep. Well, the morning of, before taking off, we actually keep him riled up. We'll play with him extra. We'll really get that energy worked out of him and not allow him to nap on the couch. Because when he gets in the truck, he's gonna wanna actually take a nap and he's out for the ride. Now, if we let him sleep here, it's quite the different story. Sometimes he'll wake up halfway through the trip like a, you know, confused baby and just start screaming and like, where are we? But hey, it works for us.
This is a new hot, hot tip for cat owners if you're RV traveling.
Or so, dog owners too.
Yes, write this one down. We'll repeat it again. Wear them out before you get on the road so they nap the whole time.
I think my biggest concern before getting into this when we were researching it was, what about bathroom breaks, especially for a cat? Dogs are a lot more easy to accommodate in that way. You can pull over wherever you want. But having a cat, it kind of throws a whole new dynamic on things.
Yeah, we were like, are we gonna have to have a litter box for the truck and a litter box for the RV? Yeah. Do we bring that one with?
Right.
Are we gonna be driving? He's just gonna be pooping back there?
We had no idea what to expect. But we found that he became quite accommodated very quickly with the travels, and we like to take a break about midway through our travel day, mm-hmm. right? So if we're traveling for 4 hours, we kind of break around 2 hours to kind of let him stretch his legs.
Yes, we try not to go more than 3 to 4 hours in one shot. Same with dogs. Whatever the dog's normal behaviors are in your home life, you want to try to follow with the RV life. Rest areas and parks are really great because of all the trees and grass.
Yep.
But we've even seen some large truck stops having dog parks. That's pretty cool.
They may be concerned about the animal staying hydrated on the road or actually having some food. We just kind of avoid all that together. The reason I say that is because cats are really great and flexible on the road. Our friends actually have dogs that they travel with, and if they run into any concerns with that, they just have an extra gallon of water on the side that they can fill up a little bowl for them. But overall, usually animals, or at least in our experience, aren't really worried about that on travel days. Just the travel day in itself is stressful enough to kind of keep them distracted from like, I'm thirsty or hungry. You can just touch on those points when you take your breaks.
So we don't put the litter box in the truck, but that raises the question, where in the RV do we put the litter box? This is a hot question.
Well, it is, because it's easily understandable. We live in such a small area. Where can you possibly stick a litter box that it's not going to be easily noticeable and smelly, yada yada?
This is where cat poop and creativity just mix in this beautiful art form.
Nice.
It's not just about finding the best spot, but taking in mind the smell. You don't want to see the litter box, but you don't want to smell it.
We actually found a great article on this online. We don't know these folks, but they have some amazing ways and different ideas to put a cat litter box on the road. I think it was rvinspiration.com.
Yeah.
We'll leave it linked in the description below if you're more of a blog reader and you like to see it for yourself by reading it. Go check that out. Pretty cool.
Oh, the pass-through storage idea. Some of you emailed us and sent us pictures of like doing this.
Yeah.
And if you're not sure what I'm talking about, some people will cut a hole that goes from their steps into the pass-through storage, which is accessed from the exterior. And that puts not just a litter box, but kind of like a little bed down there. It's like their own cat oasis.
But we chose not to do that.
Well, you're missing out on a lot of storage space. And that pass-through storage is some prime real estate if you're full-time RVing.
I think arguably we found the best space possible for our cat litter box.
And we might have purchased this RV keeping that in mind.
If you're really curious on where we keep our cat litter box, we actually hide it inside our bathroom, underneath the bathroom sink.
He's got a cute little privacy curtain there. He goes in and uses the bathroom. We can go in and use the bathroom, and everyone's stinky in one place.
It's out of sight, out of mind. It's upstairs. You're not smelling it when you walk into the RV. That's a big concern. So yeah, we stay on top of that, do a lot of sweeping of the cat litter. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, with the bathroom, the cat litter goes everywhere, no matter how much you try to stay on top of it. But the most concerning, drastic concern that we had before getting into the RV was, how do we manage the temperature within the RV? Going back to what I was saying with all those heat-related deaths at the beginning of this video, that's scary. And you want the best for your fur baby. You want to keep them protected when you're out on your adventures, maybe doing some hikes, or you're just away grabbing dinner. How do you manage that temperature?
Let me share a story with you that still terrifies us to this day. Back when we first started full-timing, we were in Northern California in the summertime, and we left for the day to go hang out with family. And we thought the AC was fine and dandy, ready to kick on when it got toasty, but we came back later that day and it was very warm inside the RV. I don't remember the temperature, but it was hot.
It was over 90 or something in that.
Yeah.
It was really hot. And the area we're in is in the Valley of California, where the temperatures get 115, 120 degrees.
Yeah.
So had we not showed up when we did, it could have ended really badly for our little guy.
Yeah.
And we're really thankful that nothing did happen. But it really kicked us in the butt to make sure we have the best tools to keep him safe now, having went through that situation.
It's all about that peace of mind.
It is. It really is. So we have some great options for you guys. The first one we're going to kick it off with is Waggle. We don't really use them anymore, but it's a great option if you're a weekender or you just like to get out on some short trips.
It basically will run off its own like network, so you don't need to have continuous Wi-Fi inside, which is nice. The only problem is we were somewhere where Verizon towers were not very good, and it ran off the Verizon tower, so we weren't able to get updates.
It's just a temperature monitoring device, so you can't make any changes. It's just gonna warn you if the temperature gets too hot or if it gets too cold.
If you're full-time RVing, most likely you're looking into some type of Wi-Fi device. Like, you're gonna have continuous Wi-Fi, whether it's Starlink or some kind of cellular pep wave. So because we upgraded to Starlink, we were like, oh my gosh, now we can invest in something that we heard about.
And it's called the MicroAir.
Mm-hmm.
Now the MicroAir does run off Wi-Fi.
Not only does it run off Wi-Fi, but it runs off Bluetooth as well. So when we get to an RV site and it's really hot, I don't even have to go inside to turn the AC on. As long as he's plugged into the 50 amp, I can just get on the Bluetooth and have the AC kick on right away.
It's great because it monitors the temperature within the RV, and then you also have full control over it. So if you need to turn on the AC if it gets too hot, or you need to turn on the heater when it gets too cold, it allows you to do everything in between that. Another really great thing about it is you can actually schedule the MicroAir to turn on like the AC whenever you want. So let's say you're leaving for the day, it's chilly, and then halfway through today, you know it's gonna get warm out. Well, you could schedule it to turn on the AC around 11 or 12 and keep the temperature around 72 to 73 degrees if you want that. We'll leave a link below for you. Check it out if it's gonna help you out on the road and keep your pet safe.
Now, the one in the description is the model that fits for our specific unit. You wanna do research and make sure you're getting the model that works, like is compatible with your RV. Just needed to make sure I got that out to you.
There's one unique aspect about our RV that we love to brag about that makes it unlike any other RV model out there. We'll leave this video right here for you. Click and watch it next, and we'll see you over there on the full tour of our RV.